All right, we are concluding our series on Galatians, living in freedom every day. And I don't know about you, but I really thoroughly enjoyed going through the book of Galatians. Every time I go through the Bible, I find something new. And it's just amazing to me how much civilizations have changed and governments have come and gone and kingdoms have come and gone. But the human condition hasn't changed very much, has it? And it's amazing to me that the book of Galatians really deals with the stuff you and I are dealing with today. And today we're going to be talking about this, how to keep on keeping on when you don't want to keep on anymore. How to keep on keeping on when you don't want to keep on anymore. How many know what I'm talking about? You ever go through something, you're like, I don't know if I can go another day in this marriage. Don't raise your hand. That's why you need to come to the conference. I don't know if I can go another day at work. One more day of this. I don't know if I can drive through Waterbury one more time with all the construction. I don't know if I can go back to church again because I'm frankly tired of hypocrites and the church that's so legalistic. I don't think I can do that anymore. And how about this? You're trying to get over something, and it just seems like you just can't get through it. You know what I'm talking about, everybody? Am I the only one up here? Okay. Well, you struggle with something. You're trying to get through something. You're like, God, what's the deal? I want to get over this. Well, today we're going to talk about how we can guarantee. Yes, I'm giving you a personal guarantee, no money back guarantee, but a guarantee that you can overcome and you can be ultimately ridiculously successful. What? Yeah, hang on. I'm telling you, this is the truth, folks. The Bible gives us hope beyond anything you can imagine. And so today we're going to be talking about how to keep on keeping on when you don't want to keep on anymore. How to keep on in a marriage, how to keep on in your work, how to keep on doing the right thing. It seems like everyone's getting a break, but you're not. Why is it that the person that you went to school with who cheated on tests and did all the wrong things, they get to go to the good school and get all the scholarships? You did the things that were right, and you're still struggling. How about this? You decided to do all these right things, and it seems like everyone else is prospering. Have you ever experienced that? I know I have. The Galatians 6:9 says the following. And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. And I looked up, you know what it means, we shall reap? It means you will reap what you sow. The Bible is making a promise here. Every time the Bible gives a promise, I take it. So you will, the Bible says, do not grow weary in well-doing. Now let me go ahead and just kind of back up a little bit and give you guys a little perspective for those of you who have not been in this series or those of you that are new here today. So I'll let you know what's going on with the book of Galatians, all right? The book of Galatians written by the Apostle Paul to our church in the region of modern-day Turkey today. And he was writing to a church that was having difficulty. There was something that was going on, that they were jealousies and there were people that were thinking they were better than other people. And what happened was the early church was Jewish. Jesus was Jewish. The early church was Jewish. But what happened was the Gentiles, which mean non-Jewish people, started coming into the church. And in fact, they started growing so fast that they started superseding the Jewish people. And you have to understand something. In that culture back in that time, if you were Jewish, you were supposed to stay away from the Gentiles. They're dirty. They're unclean. They're not as good as you are. That's what you were taught, right? And part of it was, and there's a reason for that, the reason they were taught that way, but they were called to be separate from the Gentiles. And they had all these rules and regulations, which we talked about in previous weeks. But what happened was, all of a sudden, you'd be in the church for 20 years, and someone's been there maybe a year, and they're rising up a problem. Who do you think you are? I paid my dues here at Cornerstone, and who are you? Only here a year? And you think you can do that ministry? Who do you think you are? And you know, you should got to do all these things first. And what they used to make you do, you used to make the men get circumcised. If you became to the church, and if you weren't circumcised, in order to be accepted, you had to be circumcised. That's pretty lame. Can you imagine that? And so the Apostle Paul is really upset about that. He says, you're not saved by that. You're saved by grace. And we're talking about that through this whole process. And perhaps one of the most important messages, I believe, in this series is the number one, the week number one, we talked about living in the tree of life, not in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And that particular sermon basically summarizes the whole thing. You're not living in law, you're living in relationship with Christ. And we've been talking about that week in and week out. So I want to encourage you to go back. And so today, we're concluding our time here in Galatians. And we're looking out how to keep on keeping on when you don't want to keep on anymore. And people get tired. And I don't know about you, but I love that the Bible is so real. And in Psalm 73, the psalmist is crying out to God, is frustrated. And you know what he says? He says this, in Psalm 73, verse 3. He says this. He says, I envied the proud when I saw them prosper despite the wickedness. Have you ever seen that happen? Have you ever seen someone that's doing the wrong thing and it seems like they're doing well? I mean, they did everything the wrong way. They cheat in their business. They cheat in their spouse. They do this or the other. And why are they successful? It doesn't seem fair. Here I am doing the right thing, working hard, and I'm not getting the break. I'm not getting the pay raise. I'm not getting the promotion. I'm not getting the school I'm supposed to get. I'm still single. These people are married, and they're doing great, and they're all happy, and I'm struggling. And I've seen this happen. I've seen people that I know that get so frustrated being single that they went to a parole officer and said, the first person that gets out, I'm going to marry. You know, I see people do stuff like that. Please don't do that. Wait for God's best. Wait, and don't admire an axe murderer. It's not a good idea. Well, I'll get him saved. I'm sure you will. Unless he's going to cut down a tree. Okay, that's beside the point. But I've seen people get so impatient with God that they jump it. And they miss out what God's calling them to do. And I want to encourage you today that there is a guarantee that you can be successful in the true meaning of what God would have for us. So we read this in the scriptures here. In verse 3, for I envy the proud, and I saw them prosper despite their wickedness. They seem to live in such painless lives, right? Their parents are healthy, their kid, even their dog is healthy, even the cat is healthy. Everyone's healthy. You buy a goldfish, it dies, you know, no matter what you do. And meanwhile, everything they do, they're doing well, and it's frustrating. And then he goes on in the same chapter, the psalmist talks about this, and which I believe really kind of helps us to deal with what we're dealing with today, keep on keeping on, is this. He says in verse 12, look at these wicked people enjoying a life of ease while the riches multiply. You invested in all the dot-coms, you lost all your money. These people, you know, they invest in Apple, then they sell it at $400, now it's $100, and they made out. And it is everything they do well, right? And you're like, what's going on? Look at these wicked people enjoying a life of ease while their riches multiply. They even run for president, okay? And did I keep my heart pure for nothing? I have no political ambitions, no commentary. I just threw it in there, okay? Verse 13, did I keep my heart pure for nothing? God, what's the deal? I've tried. I can barely pay rent. I can barely move forward. I can barely get out of bed. Did I keep myself innocent for no reason? I get nothing but trouble all day long. Every morning brings me pain. That's in the Bible. Aren't you glad the Bible's real? It just talks about what's going on. And maybe some of you feel that way. You know, I've tried to overcome this situation in my life, this drinking problem, this anger problem, this problem, you know, all these issues. I've tried, and then I drove through Waterbury, and I lost my temper. Okay, I've been trying to get through these things. Don't drive through Waterbury during rush hour. I know that from personal experience. I almost lost my salvation the other day. But, but I'm doing good. I'm doing good. But ever been there? Perhaps you're there right now. You're just struggling. And how about this? You know, I'm reading through the Bible in a year, which I really encourage you to do. We're doing it together as a church. And here's Gideon. And I have you to put that up there if you could, Brian. So Judges 6:13 says this. And here's Gideon speaking to God. He says the following. Gideon replied, if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to me? If the Lord is really with us, then why is my dear friend's wife, why does she have brain cancer? If the Lord's really with us, serving God. Meanwhile, you have these other people that are doing horrible things and their family's healthy, their kids are doing well, everything they do flourishes. Why is it God? Why is it God? And I'm saying that, folks, because this morning my heart's grieved for my friend. And, you know, and he serves God and his wife is struggling. I'm going to pray right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for my friend Martha. Lord, I pray that whatever they're going through right now, I pray that you'd bring blessing upon her, that you'd heal her of this horrible tumor that's in her mind, in her brain. We ask you to bring comfort to the family in Jesus' name. Amen. My friend says we're holding strong. We're trusting God in the middle of all this. And then we get upset because our hairbrush broke in the morning. I mean, think about it. And it says right here, I get nothing but trouble, and every morning brings me pain. Maybe that's you this morning. Maybe you're like, I know, I'm going to give Christianity one more week, and then I'm going to give up on it. I'm tired. I've tried. It doesn't work. They said tithe. I tithe. My car broke, and the laundry machine broke. It doesn't work. I'm going to forget about it. I tried to marry a Christian, date a Christian person, and they were crazy. So I'm going out. I'm going to go someplace else, you know? And I've seen it happen. And so even the Bible understands this type of thing. And I heard people talk about all the time. I said, why can't I just get an easy break? I've tried. And I think the mistake we often make is this. We just expect things to happen like this. And if it doesn't happen in our timeline, we give up. We give up too fast. We live in a microwave culture. And I've learned something. God's more of a crockpot God. He tends to work through us. And by the way, have you noticed that microwave food stinks? Some of you eat Hot Pockets. They're terrible for you, right? I'd much rather have a well-cooked, slow meal. And many times, we want quick things to happen, and God does that. And I've seen people, by the way. I worked at a drug rehab one summer, and I saw a guy that was on heroin. I mean, a big heroin addict for over 10 years. He got prayed for, and he was completely delivered of all withdrawal symptoms. He was off heroin and was living a great life. Okay? And meanwhile, I'm struggling with something I can't seem to get over. What's the deal with that, God? How come this person gets over it and I can't? Well, I mean, maybe it works for this other person, but it doesn't work for me. Why is it happening that way? And I've noticed that, and I noticed that people, we see that in someone else's life. You're like, I want to experience like that. And it's because God doesn't deliver like he delivered in someone else's life. You know what I've learned? That everyone has a pain. Everyone has a story. The people you look after so much, you know what? They got their stuff too. The longer I've been alive, I've met some very successful people. I've had the privilege of meeting very successful people, even some national figures. I'm just saying this. I'm not trying to pat myself on the back, but I've had the opportunity to. You know what? They're human beings, and they got pain. They got issues. You know why? This is not heaven yet. And so you're going to have pain in life sometimes. And I think we want God to zap us. If I could just come forward and they would pray for me. If I got everything, some of you get prayed for so much, you should be bald by now. Your hands being laid upon you all the time and you're not seeing what's happening. That's why I don't have much hair left. You know what God sees? He looks down from you. If you have hair, you know what God sees? He looks down. He sees nothing. But when God looks down on me, he sees his reflection. You guys are slow this morning. Okay. Thank you. That was like a delayed response. It was like a 5-second delay there. Okay. Oh, thank you. Thank you. I'm happy with my hairline. Okay. But we often want God to move quickly, and often he doesn't move as quick as we want him to move. What do we do? I have encouraged you today. Keep on keeping on. Do not grow weary in well-doing. Our basic scripture verse we're taking off from, we're going to land with, is Galatians 6:9. It says this, and let us not grow weary. Why would the apostle Paul say weary? Because sometimes, my friend, it gets weary. Sometimes it's difficult. I'll never forget when we had our first child, Luke, and I was telling my wife, push. You know, it was a long, oh, I don't know if I can do it. And thank God, you know, and we kept on moving on. Thank God I wasn't her, because believe me, if I had to have children, we'd have no children. I can tell you that right now. If I had to birth a child, I would never birth a child. God bless my wife. Anyhow, but we'd have to push, and we'd like, push. We got to push forward. Don't give up. And you're wondering, can I really get past this? And there's been times in my life where I'm wondering, God, can I really get through this, God? Can I really see success? Am I going to come to the end of this road, or is this the end? Now, I've talked to some people that struggle with depression and anxiety, and they're like, I don't know if I can go another day. I said, hold on, a better day is coming. And then they get through it. Don't give up. Do not give up. Let us not grow weary in what? While doing good. Doesn't mean doing stupid stuff, okay? Mean doing good. For in due season, in a due season, we shall reap it. Some of you are so impatient. You plant an apple tree in December, and you're expecting by January 10th, you're going to have apples on the tree. Well, God must not love me. You got to cultivate goodness and faithfulness, and the Bible is true. You will reap if you do not lose hope. I love what it says in Psalm 53, and it talks about, 73, excuse me, all the difficulty. And then today we're going to look at Galatians chapter 6, and we're going to actually almost read the whole thing again because it speaks so clearly what we're dealing with here today. But let's go ahead and look at it. Verse 1 says this, "Brethren, is a man or woman, for this matter, is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a person in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted." And listen to this. "Bear one another's burdens and fulfill the law of Christ." And the law of Christ is to love each other as Christ has loved you. It says, bear each other's burdens. In other words, you're not supposed to go through life all by yourself, bearing the burden of life all by yourself. We're not called to live this life by ourselves. We're not, it doesn't work this way. Christianity is a family. Christianity, in the true sense of the word, the body of Christ is supposed to be a body. And the reason why it doesn't work is you need somebody, not nobody. You need the body of Christ to help you grow. But we're going to show you we talked about getting under the, helping each other with our loads and our burdens, right? We continue to move on. "For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. But let each of us examine his own work, and then we'll have rejoicing in himself alone, not in another. For each one shall bear his own load." Wait a minute here. You got verse 5 saying you got to bear your own load, and in verse 2 says bear each other's load. Well, what's the story with that? How's that supposed to work? I'll tell you how it's supposed to work is this. God has given each of you a responsibility, and no one can fulfill it except for you. There are certain things that God has put on my plate that no one else can do but me. However, you can stand alongside of me. I cannot walk Sandra's Christian life, my wife's Christian life for her. I cannot read the Bible for her. I cannot pray the prayer of faith for her. I cannot follow God for her. I can stand with her. I can encourage her, and she does the same to me, but she has her own burden she's got to carry. I'll help her, but she's got to carry her own burden. And your kids got to carry their own burden. Okay? But we can help each other, but we still have to carry our own burden. Does that make sense, everybody? Jesus says, "My burden is light, my yoke is easy," but there's still a yoke and there's still a burden that we have to carry. And so it says, verse 5, "So each one shall bear his own load. Let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man or woman sows, that he or she will reap. For he or she who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he or she who sows in the spirit of the spirit will reap everlasting life." We're talking about everlasting life here, folks. It doesn't say at the end of the day. It doesn't say at the end of the month. It doesn't say after the end of the fiscal year. It doesn't say at the end when you retire. It says everlasting life. See, what's talking about here is reaping something that's eternal, not temporary. The problem you and I often have is we have temporary goals wanting eternal blessings. You see, this doesn't really work on temporary. You have to think of the eternal. My friends, you and I are eternal beings. We're either with Christ forevermore or we're separated from evermore in a place called hell. Yes, there is a hell. It's separated from God. You know what hell is? It is a burning like nothing else you've ever heard or ever seen. You want to see godlessness in this world? You see the genocide that's taking place in different places around the world? You see what's going on? That's godless. Imagine that. And yes, there is a place to that. "Do not be deceived. God's not mocked. For whatever a man sows, he will also reap. For who he sows to the flesh will reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary while doing," this ain't grow weary doing bad, "but while doing good, do not give up." Do not give up. Do not stop. "For in due season, we shall," it doesn't say you might, it says we shall, you will, reap. Take in if we do not lose heart. And so what's one of the things that has to happen? I tell you what's really important. Hope is very important. Without hope, you can't cope. Let me say that again. Without heavenly hope, you can't cope. Hope is something that is in the future that's not yet realized. I have a hope in God. You and I should have a hope in God. And so let's just finish off the chapter, and we're going to break it down a little bit more. Okay, everybody? So let's continue on. It says in verse 9, we talked about that, not lose heart. Verse 10, therefore we have the opportunity, let us do good to all, especially those who are in the house of the faith. So it's saying we should help cultivate a community life in Christ Jesus. It says take care of your teachers, take care of the church, take care of each other. If someone's struggling, help each other out. You help me, I help you. However, you still have to carry your own load. And don't think too highly of yourself. If it was not for Jesus Christ, none of us could stand. This whole thing of Galatians has been what Christ has done for us. It's not about what I've done, it's about what Christ has done for us. So get involved. And the only way this is really going to work and we're going to be able to overcome, my friends, is we're going to have to be connected to Christ and connected to each other. And the Apostle Paul says here, see, verse 11, with large letters I have written you with my own hand. You know the Apostle Paul has an ailment? He didn't always walk in victory and healing. He has a thorn in his flesh. We don't know what it was. He says in one of the chapters that my eyes were so messed up, you guys would have given me your own eyes if you could. And he writes with big letters. People believe he had bad eyesight. The Apostle Paul didn't have an easy life, but he kept moving on and going on. He goes on to say in verse 12, as many as desire to make good, showing in the flesh, these would compel you to be circumcised. So about doing the law. Only that they must suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. In other words, they're trying to say, these people want to do all this church stuff without the relationship with Christ. Verse 13, for not even those who are circumcised keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised that they may boast in your flesh. What this is all about is people that are following rules and regulations. I don't do this. I don't do this. I vote this way. I do this way. And because of that, I'm righteous and I'm good. And the Apostle Paul is saying that's not what it's about. It's not about that. And we'll see in a few moments here. But listen to the Apostle Paul here. But God forbid that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me just stop there for a second. Do you realize that you and I were designed to be confident? And yes, boastful. God has put something in your DNA to be boastful and to be confident and to have your head raised high and walk into a room and say, I am loved and I am accepted and I have a purpose and I can walk into this room no matter where I am, I can be confident in God. But you know how that happens? That happens only in a life that is completely surrendered to Jesus Christ. You see, what happens is In the Garden of Eden, we left that behind and disconnected ourselves from God. And then we took our fig leaves and tried to cover with other things. Many of us try to be confident in church stuff. We try to be confident in ourselves. You see, the thing is, you're designed to be confident and, yes, boastful in the right way. Boastful, and I'm boastful about God. That's a good thing, by the way, to be boastful about God, not yourself. And so we're designed to be that way. And so it's something that we have. And so what we try to do is we try to be confident, we try to be boastful in our own self. And that causes competition. Do you see that? Now look what the Apostle Paul says here. Verse 14, but God forbid that I should boast except of the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. And so this is the key, my friends. If you want to keep on keeping on, this is the first thing. If you're taking notes, write this down. If you're not taking notes, write it down. This is the first thing we have to do. We have to crucify ourselves to the world and to ourselves. Oswald Chambers, My Utmost for His Highest, one of my favorite devotionals of all time, has a chapter, one of his daily readings says this, every day you and I need a white funeral. Every day, I should get up and I should lay myself in a casket and say, here lies Eric Bucci. May he rest in peace. He is now alive to Christ. Jesus is not longer I who live, but Christ in me. The moment it's about you and the moment it's about me is the moment you and I have conflict, insecurities. How could they say that about me? And we worry about ourselves. This is what causes problems in churches. This is what causes problems. I mean, well, who do you think you are? And, you know, if everything I do is based upon how good I can make the church be, or how well I listen to the Bible, how well I don't do bad things, it's all about do, instead of being about Jesus Christ and what he's done for me and what he's done for you. And so he says, I boast in nothing but Christ in me. You see, we're supposed to boast, but we're supposed to boast a Christ in us and through us. We're supposed to have confidence, but we look for a facsimile of that confidence in ourselves. For verse 15, for in Christ Jesus neither circumcised nor uncircumcised avails anything, but a new creation. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. The only way you can be a new creation is the old creation has to die. I have to die. You have to die. And if this is the thing, every day we have to die. You know, the Muslims have something right. They have to pray 5 times a day. Why do they pray 5 times a day? Remind themselves. And I'm not saying their religion is completely false. But you know what? You know what a successful life is? You know what a successful godly life is? It's a series of successful days, successful weeks, months, and years. And if you're like me, sometimes I can't even get through a day without pulling Jesus off the cross and saying, I'm in charge again. Every day, we have to sacrifice. We have that white funeral. To be a new creation, the old creation has to die. Otherwise, it does not work, because it's not a new creation, it's the old creation. You see that, everybody? Well, how do you do that? Well, I'll tell you what has to happen. It amazes me. If I'm driving through Waterbury traffic, and someone cuts me off, and I run into a pothole and bend the rim of my car and pop the tire, the old Eric wants to get out of a bazooka. I want to get out of the car, right? And so I have a choice here. Am I going to demonstrate my fluency in sign language, which I don't do? Am I going to get upset? Am I going to, or what does God say? And so how many times if someone insults me immediately, oh, I can't believe they did that. I'm going to show them. And wait a minute. Okay, I got a choice here. Am I going to let the old creation die and have a new creation? In other words, when someone offends you, everybody, and by the way, when you get offended, because you will get offended by somebody or something, situation, ask yourself the question, why am I offended? Is it because of Christ? Because I'm not treating with respect, or is it because of my own thing? I don't know why people don't do that. If we could all just do that, most of our problems would go away. And I'm so thankful that Sandra and I hold each other accountable. You know, I'm upset about something. Well, what is the, well, you know, with the Bible, this, I don't preach me right now. You know, I don't want to hear that right, but you know what? She's right. And so we remind ourselves that, look, what the Word of God says, this is the standard. Don't be jealous. This is the standard we're supposed to have. And so if the reason I'm upset is not valid according to the Bible, guess what has to go? It's the old creation. We are a new creation in Christ Jesus. And so he goes on and he says that in verse 15, but in Christ neither circumcised nor uncircumcised avails anything. In other words, church rules and regulation is nothing but a new creation you need to have. From now on, let's no one trouble me, for I bear my body the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. The whole thing has been about getting out of this legalistic mindset of trying to do stuff to accept God and realize that God has accepted you. But the only way this works is that you and I have to have that white funeral. The old creation has to die, and the new creation has to come up. And my friends, it is a daily. Jesus says, whoever wants me to be my disciple has to pick up their cross once in their life. No, pick up their cross daily. Daily, every day, I got to die. You know, the beautiful thing is, when I die, I live. I mean, think about it. All the problems we have, all the issues we have is because we have something inside of us screaming out, I want it my way. I want to be important. I want you to love me. I want you to give me comfort. I want you to give me peace. And we scream about other people. We're like little babies. Why not just say, I'm going to let it go. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. I'm confident in Christ. And so I want to encourage you with this. You know what it says in Psalm 37? We start off with Psalm 37 talking about those that were not following God, the evil prosper while the good gets suffering, right? We know what he says. The psalmist says the following. He says this, commit thy way unto the Lord, trust in him, and he shall bring it to pass. We should delight ourselves in the Lord, and he will give us the desires of our heart. You see, it's real simple, but it's so profound, and it's so simple is that we have to be willing to die to ourselves and say, God, it's not about me, it's about you and me. But this is how it works here. In Hebrews 11:6, it says the following, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must what? Believe that he is, and is a rewarder of those who once in a while try. No, those who diligently seek him. You see, do not grow weary in well-doing, for in due time you will reap a harvest if you do not lose heart. The Bible says without faith, it's impossible for him to please God. We must believe he exists, and he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. You know, there's something else I've learned through life. Have you heard of big momentum? When you get momentum with a locomotive, if I put a rock in front of of this wheel of a locomotive, it won't be able to go over it. But you get that locomotive going on a consistent basis, it gets momentum. Then what happens? It's very hard to stop it. Godliness is like that. You are faithful day in, day out, day in, day out, day in. You stop looking for the instantaneous miracles and start being faithful daily. Let me tell you something right now. That will create momentum in your life and my life. This is how I've gotten anywhere in God, is I've been faithful. I wish God gave me the big grand slam miracles. I don't get the grand slam miracles. You know what I get? I get the one step every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, moving forward, moving forward, moving forward. There's been things in my life that I had to walk through, building this building, and getting all that hasn't been easy, folks. You guys, okay, I'm going one step at a time, one step at a time, one step at a time. And as I take one step, I get momentum. And momentum is doing the right thing in the right place. And God gives us that. He gives us habits to help us out. The Bible talks about all these various things. And the Bible, I want to once again reiterate verse 7 of Galatians 6 says this, whatever a man soweth, that shall he shall reap. For he that soweth to the flesh shall reap corruption. He who sows in the Spirit will reap everlasting life. So what it's about is having that white funeral and sowing in to the good things of God, sowing into what's right and pure and holy. Okay, here's some closing steps, what we can do about this, all right? We mentioned the first thing to do. In order to be able to not grow weary in well-doing and reach the reward, the first thing we got to do, my friends, is daily be willing to have a white funeral. Be willing to die daily. As Paul said, I boast in nothing but Christ crucified in me. We have to be willing to be crucified to the world. It's not about me anymore. You know, that's the freest thing in your world. The greatest problem in your life is selfishness. It is. The greatest problem in a marriage is selfishness. The greatest problem in church strife is selfishness. The greatest problem in sibling rivalry is selfishness. The greatest problem in nations fighting other nations is selfishness. The greatest problem in political problems is selfishness. You get rid of self and you get Christ in, and you know what happens? It begins to bring momentum and healing to God's blessing. It says, plan for the harvest. Plan for it. Choose to die yourself. Then you got to do cultivate the field. Cultivate righteousness. Do the right thing. Continue to stay in the right thing. Come to church every week. Get involved in a small group. Have other believers that are helping you along the way. Read the word every day. What is that supposed to do? Give me one 12-month year where you make it a priority to come to church every week. And don't just come to church so you can put it off your checklist, but come to church and participate in church. Come through Growth Track. Get involved with a small group. Get to know somebody. I don't like that small group. We'll try a different one. All right? Get involved with a small group. Serve someplace in the church. Do something to help someone else out. Read the word every day. And 12 months from now, if you're not a better person, I'll quit. I'll quit because it's not working. It works, my friends. It works. Cultivate it. And so this is all part of it. And finally, I want to mention this, and this is part of is this. Finish what you start. Don't give up. Keep marching on. Do not stop. You know, they did a little study. You know, they found this. I read this past week, that they were trying to figure out why Japanese students in Japan are more successful in mathematics than a lot of American school children. And they were trying to figure out what it was. You know what they found out the reason was? It's amazing. That the American child would work on a problem for about 9.4 minutes while the Japanese child lasted 14 minutes. And they determined that was the difference. It was not the genetics. It was because they tried longer. You and I give up too fast. Do not give up on well-doing. You will reap a reward if you do not lose heart. Listen to this. This is very, very important. It's the most important point today, except for dying daily, is this. Set your goal beyond this world. You can't expect to have eternal rewards by having temporary goals. You can't expect to have eternal rewards by setting temporary goals. My friends, you and I are made beyond this life. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, 6, and it is impossible, we mentioned it before, to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to him must believe he exists and that he's a rewarder, right? Then, do you realize that the great men and women of the Bible did not receive what they were promised in their lifetime? Do you know that Abraham, the father of Judaism, and we're grafted in, the father of basically world evangelism, is Abraham? Do you realize that Abraham, when he died, he had a few children and had a lot of money, but he was not the father of many nations? So he died not seeing the results of that. You and I would say, he's a failure, father of many nations. Pah! Look at him. Yeah, he's got some money. Yeah, he's got some cattle. He got some nice camels over there. But anyhow, yeah, big deal. He's not a father of many nations. But look now. Billions and billions of people now are of the faith of Christ because of one man God used. And one man to bring a nation, to bring salvation to the world. But in his lifetime, he did not see it. Why? Why? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 11, excuse me, verse 13. These all met their goals while they were alive. Doesn't say that, does it? No. These all died in what? Faith. Not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed them. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. But my child is in rebellion. I don't care. I'm going to confess it. And by my dying day, when I go to heaven, the prayers, the things I've done, I believe God is going to hear that prayer, and he's going to work in my family line. You got to start claiming the promises of God and stop looking at here. That's not the goal. The goal is eternity. You are an eternal being, not a temporary being. Stop making temporary goals. You should be making eternal goals. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off. They were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed them, that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. We are passing through. We are soldiers. Sometimes we go on shore leave, but you got to get back in the platoon, folks. This is not about you. The reason it doesn't work is because it's not about you. It's about him. Verse 14, for those who say such things declare plainly that they speak of a homeland. Oh, yeah, these pie-in-the-sky Christians, all they think about is the hereafter. You know, it isn't about that, and, you know, I don't like that at all. I like what C.S. Lewis said. He says this. If you read history, you'll find that Christians who did the most for the present world were those who thought most of the next. The people that make the most difference in the world are the people that shoot to make a difference in the kingdom of heaven forever. My friends, you may not see the fruit of your labor at this side of heaven. You may feel like you're a failure, but if you're faithful and do what God's called you to do, you will reap an eternal reward, and you will reap the harvest. I promise you. Why? It's in Scripture. You will. You will. And what does he say? How do we do this? Die daily. Keep walking in the right direction. Don't give up. And here, as we conclude today, Hebrews 12, verse 1 says the following. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, in other words, all the men, he gave a great discourse about all the great men and women of faith who did not receive the promises in their lifetime, but saw them afar off. This is what he says. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which so easily ensnares us. Listen, sin comes easy, folks. Let's lay it aside. Let's lay aside. Oh, I don't like what he did to me. How could they do that to me? Lay it aside. And let us run with what? Endurance. Don't give up. Keep on keeping on. The race set before us. Why? How do we do it? We look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Now listen, how is God supposed to be the author of your life if you're holding onto the pen? I'm writing my own chapters. Why not open your heart up and say, God, I'm going to delight myself in you. Now you give me the desires of my heart. The problem is we don't trust God. You think if you give yourself to God, you're going to be in a dugout canoe in someplace in Amazon getting blown darts at you or something like that, all right? I'm going to be having a naked Indian blowing darts at me if I give my life to Christ. That's not what's going to happen, okay? Listen, God has put desires in you. Why not just surrender? Stop trying to do it your own way. The Bible says here, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Let Jesus write in your heart, but you got to be willing to give up the pen. You got to be willing to get your hands off the bookends and say, God, you write in my heart. Let him be the writer. Let him be the author and the completer of your faith. Why? Here it is, guys. Listen to this. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Listen to this. This is so important. Who for the joy that was set before him. Why do we worship with hands up in church and singing, bless the Lord, O my soul? Why? Because we set the joy before him. This is temporary. Heaven is forever. Joy is forever. You have to set the joy before you. When Stephen, the first martyr of the church, he looked into heaven and saw the throne room. Rocks are being hurled at him, and he was praising God and blessing those who persecuted him. My friends, you are aiming too low. A good retirement and kids well adjusted is too low. Aim higher to change the world. Aim higher to give it all to God. Aim higher to an eternal reward. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher, who for the joy set before him. How did Jesus endure the nails? How did he endure the whipping, the beating? How did he endure my son? My father, why have you forsaken me? It's for the joy set before him. Do you have the joy set before him? Or do you have some paltry little goals of this earth set before you? Set a goal so high that you reach it by God's grace. For consider him who endured such hostility himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not resisted to the point of bloodshed. Galatians 6:9. And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap. My good and faithful servant, enter into my joy today. Every one of us can be an ultimate winner and has such a great reaping. The Bible promises you will win, but you gotta set your goal higher than this place. And by doing so, you'll have more impact in this world by reaching to heaven you ever will down here. Let's pray. Father, in the matchless name of Jesus Christ, I wanna thank you for your greatness upon our lives. Father, we wanna thank you that you've given us a reason to live. Lord, you put eternity in the heart of man. And Father, we recognize the only way we're going to be able to do this thing is to completely let the old creation die. Let a new creation happen inside of us today. Lord, we're sorry for putting goals that are so temporary. We're sorry for being selfish. We're sorry for giving up when, Lord, we got to look beyond. Lord, I pray for this church that we would invest ourselves. We would stop doing it all by ourselves. God, that we would say, I'm going to commit myself to a local body, whether this church or another church. I'm going to commit myself to a local body. I'm going to become accountable. I'm going to know people. I'm going to serve. And I'm going to grow in Jesus' name. With every head bowed today, I'm going to ask you a question today. Are you really Jesus? Listen, just yesterday I got a text from someone in this church. We have a gentleman that cuts our grass here at the church. He got broadsided and died. 28-year-old young man died yesterday. You do not know when your time is up. Are you sure you're going to meet Christ if you were to die? Well, I'm a pretty good person. I do the right thing. I go to church. It isn't about that. You have to receive what Christ has done for you. You can't make yourself right. All you have to do is give up to go up. You have to give up to go up to Christ. And saying, no longer is it me, it's Christ in me. You have to be willing to say, God, I give my life to you. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. If you're willing to do that today, let's pray right now. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you love me so much that you died on the cross for me. I receive what you've done. I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died on the cross and rose again from the dead. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. Lord, I give you all of my junk, all of it. Lord, I don't know how to clean myself up, but I do know this. I entrust you to help me to become the person you've called me to become. I hand over all rights of my life to you. I declare I am no longer my own. I am now yours. I give my life afresh to you today in Jesus' name. With every head bowed, this is going to help me to help you. And the Bible talks about acknowledging. I'm going to ask you this morning, say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer for the first time. I recommitted my life today. I'm going to say a quick show of hands. Come on. Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Anyone else? Come on, let's be real. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Listen, on these connection cards, in the back there, it says this. It says, I've committed myself to Christ. It also says, for the first time or another time. If you could fill that out, please. We want to help you out. We have classes to help you and things of that nature. We want to be able to help you with that. Okay? Otherwise, I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward at this time. We're going to go ahead and pass out the elements. We're going to have a communion. If you've given your life to Christ, then you can are more than welcome to do this. If you're willing to forgive anyone that's hurt you, then you can do this. Jesus was broken so we could be whole, everybody. Isn't that good news? He forgave us, so we should forgive each other. If you've given your life to Christ and you want to forgive each other, then you're welcome to join in with us today. I want to encourage you, some of you, you prayed that prayer today or just your first time, I want to encourage you to go to that class today. It's called Connect. It's actually going to help give you tools to run the race that's set before you. I guarantee you, this will be a blessing to you. Come today to class. We got extra food. We got other folks in there who are just the same as me and I. We're all on this journey together. I'm not better than you. You're not better than me. We're on this together, guys. We're a family growing to become what God has called us to become. I want to encourage you today to come. 12:30, right next door on your right-hand side. We got lunch for you, okay? All right. Has everyone had their elements passed out yet? I'm sorry. I should have done a little sooner. So I want to encourage you with that. Jesus took the bread and said, this is my body which has been broken for you. We're the body of Christ. And because it was broken, we can become whole, everybody. Let's go wait a couple more moments. So elements go around. Okay. Well, let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you that your body's been broken for us. Lord, I pray for broken relationships. I pray for broken bodies. I pray for broken minds and emotions to be healed, Lord God. We thank you for what you did on the cross. It cancels the power of sin and death, and that we're more than conquerors through you. We thank you for your body today. Everyone take, eat. After they supped, Jesus said, this is my blood. What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What pays for everything? His blood. What sets us free? His blood. What does his blood mean? His blood simply means this. He died in your place. Take everyone drink. Let's all stand if we could, please. And I'm going to ask our prayer team to make their way down. If you want prayer for any reason at all, if you fill all these cards, say, could you please do me a favor? Can you put it in one of the brown boxes as you walk out, or bring it to one of the folks in front that are praying? We want to send you something. We want to help you guys. Listen, we're all in this together, everybody. I'm no better than you. We're all on a journey together for God's greatness in our lives. Everybody, okay? Let's conclude. Thank you. Let's lift him up and let's make a difference in the world together, everybody. God bless you. You're dismissed. If you need prayer, come forward. Love to have you come to the class today. God bless you.